Tonight at the Internet Cafe, Women on the Web. From Beijing to Bayonne, women are talking on WomensNet. Fat, so what? Check out Fatso and Fat Girls, two websites where it doesn't matter how big you are. Need help setting up your own woman's website? You'll find everything you need at Women Online, plus creative.net, where exotic dancers found a way to organize for better working conditions. And free software, a Michelle Pfeiffer movie clip, and a JPEG Mona Lisa in our cyber blast. Women on the Web, tonight at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet here at CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California, again with Jane Wither, Andrew deVries. You know, we've been here about 4 or 5 weeks now. We've met a lot of interesting people, done a lot of interesting things here on the net. It occurs to me it's worth kind of zooming out for a minute and make the observation that this is not just another toy to be played with. This is not another thing you do with a PC. I think we're really seeing the net, the web, as a revolution. I mean, this
Absolutely.
Is a fundamentally different way of organizing people, of organizing information, of breaking that monopoly of the access to information, different relationships of power between people now. And I think there's an issue to really explain to the rest of the world that may not get it. But there's this new country, there's this new culture forming here, and I think we have a job to kind of get these two sides talking.
Well, you know, the other thing is that it's there's not this great big chasm between the two of them, because it's just really a lot more friendly, it's a lot more intuitive than it used to be. So it's a lot easier to communicate using the web. And like, for example, for me, computers a long time ago, I didn't want to touch them because they were so flat and they didn't speak to me. But now I can go on the web and they have chat lines, they have, you know, places where I can get information I never thought possible to get information and that timely.
So it's changed the way you do stuff.
Absolutely.
Really,
spectacular.
And what's exciting to me is that the word representation comes to mind, and you have so many diverse groups, groups that really never had a voice before, are now out on the net, out on the web, putting up their information. I think one of the most underrepresented groups in history probably has been women in general. And tonight we're actually going to see a lot of different sites and meet a lot of different women that are using the web and that power to bring a very exciting and new message to a mass audience.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting.
Okay,
yeah.
Women on the Web tonight at the Internet Cafe.
Hi, Susan. What are you doing?
Hi, Jane. I'm looking at the Women's Net website.
Tell me a little bit about Women's Net.
Women's Net is a global feminist network that women are using to communicate with each other all around the world, or to publish their websites, or set up an email address, or a mailing list.
Okay, so what kind of things would I find if I wasn't involved in it, but I wanted to get some information at the Women's Net? What kind of site would I find?
Well, on the website and also in private conferences or news groups, you'll find a lot of information about women, on women in health or women in labor.
Wait a second, women in labor or women
not
in
women
labor?
In labor.
Oh, okay, I wasn't sure.
Labor issues as they relate to women, and also women in technology, and all of those other issues, as well as international news that relates to women and other resources, maybe books that are out of print, like some of Andrea Dworkin's past publications are there that are no longer being published in print.
So now, weren't you involved in the Beijing conference too? Is that reflected at the Women's Net as well?
Or? It is. The Beijing site is still on the Women's Net site.
And so what was that all about? Because I know there was a big story behind this. I mean, other than Hillary Rodham Clinton coming to Beijing, but I know there was a lot of work that went behind that. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Women's Net, with a global partnership, participated in the Women's Networking Project, which was about 2 years of preparation for the World Conference on Women, where we did regional trainings about the internet and how to use the internet, and we got a lot of women's organizations online who are going to go to Beijing and using this technology to prepare and strategize for the conference, as well as share information and get UN documents and other documents that they really needed in preparation for working there.
So once they were there, they had all the information they needed and they could get right down to business. So
correct.
That's cool.
And also, when they were there, we set up a site actually in China that was connected to the internet. We brought 2 Sun machines in, and there are about 100 computers there, and we gave out email addresses for free so that women who are participating at the conference could email back and forth to their home offices. They could also access all of the documents that they needed And we also created the Beijing website, which allowed us to immediately post information and news about what was going on at the conference. And
that so everything was really current. So now, now that was about a year ago, I think. So has there been any follow-up? Are there places where, I mean, if I was interested in getting more information about the women's conference and what came out of that, and if there's any, you know, ongoing action items, where would I go? Where would be some places I could get more information?
Well, again, there are a bunch of links off of the WomensNet Beijing page, and there is a lot of follow-up activities in many of the different countries. In the U.S., you can go to the Interagency Council on Women's site, and you can find basically what the U.S. delegation committed to in Beijing and how they're doing on those commitments and what has been done.
So what does interagency mean? This is a new term for me. Is that
It was a council appointed before the U.S. delegation went to Beijing by President Clinton. And the interagency means that it answers directly to the president and can oversee and assess how the other councils, for example, the Economic Council or the Council on Labor, are dealing with issues as they impact.
Related to the conference. So they're actually just keeping tracks on everybody to make sure they actually do something.
Correct.
So we didn't spend all that time at the conference for nothing. That's really interesting.
Exactly.
So let me ask you about another question. Is are there places where I can get information about specifically what the hot topics were from the women's conference? I mean, obviously from those events, there's summary. There must be some place where I can get a summary, because I don't want to delve down necessarily in all the detail. Where would I go for that?
There are really good summaries either on the United Nations site, the UN site, or at One World. And One World does an interesting thing, because a hot item was how women are portrayed in media and how women have or do not have access to media. And they've broken down the different topics, women in violence, poverty, women's access to information, and they've tracked media topics, whether it's in print or TV or something related to those topics.
That's interesting. So there's actually quite a lot of information that we can get just about the conference and all the things that came out of it.
Right.
Thanks a lot for your time. It was really interesting.
Thank you.
Hi ladies, my name is Nina Rage, and I hope that you're enjoying this segment of Internet Cafe. Next time you're on the web, I hope you'll take a moment and visit our site at Divanet. We have the largest selection of fetish fashion clubwear you'll find anywhere on the web, with sizzling hot latex fashions from Skin 2 in London, to the best from San Francisco's own Stormy Leather, Dark Garden Corsetry, and Catherine Courtney Designs. If you're looking for the highest, spikiest patent leather pumps and boots, we are the sole North American distributor outlet for Ritual Shoes and Boots in London. We also have a huge selection of jewelry, videos, magazines, erotic books, CD-ROMs, and bondage toys. If you get bored shopping at this site, you ain't got a pulse.
All right, so Marilyn, your site is called Fatso, and let's get the punctuation right.
Fat,
exclamation mark, so question mark. Fatso.
Right, like, so what? So what's the big deal whether you're fat or thin? I think that we're really obsessed with this, and it's a big waste of time because life's too short for self-hatred and celery sticks.
Now, you say it's not really a support group kind of thing for fat women?
It's more for people who are ready to be outraged at the way fat people are treated and who just want to get on with their lives and have fun because they know that they're fat and funky and they're fat and their lives are great anyway. You know, there's nothing wrong with it.
All right, the site's called Fat Zone. We're talking about fat people. I mean, is that politically incorrect to say that?
No, and in fact, I think it's a political act to claim the word and use it because there's so much fear and shame around it. You know, and people say, oh, I would hate to be fat. That's, you know, often they'd rather have a leg amputated than be fat, which I find really sad because I have a great life.
You're saying I'm fat, big deal.
I think, you know, people of all sizes need to not worry about that extra 5 pounds. It's an incredible waste of time.
Really?
And it's boring to
so
listen
it's
to
tall,
people's
short,
diets.
Fat, yeah. So what?
It's just another adjective.
All right,
use
now it's
it.
A very distinctive website. It's all pink on black. It's kind of the
pink
shade of your hair.
It's a good color. It's marketing,
right?
But
and it's all big fat letters, so it's very cleverly done.
Yeah,
let's talk about some of the areas on your site.
Sure.
You've got what? Aunt Agony, I think it's called.
Aunt Agony gives out advice. She styles herself after the advice columnists in England who are agony aunts, which means that people write to them with their agonizing questions.
So what kind of questions does she get?
The best one I love is where someone wrote in complaining that every time she buys jeans, they wear out really fast because her legs rub together and the inner thigh wears out. So Antigone simply said, we'll try to engage in more activities where your legs don't meet. You know, sometimes as a fat person, you got to get creative.
All right. And now there's another section that's really called Morphin Oprah, I think.
Yeah, Mighty
Morphin Oprah. What's that about?
She gets fat, she gets thin, she gets fat, she gets thin, just like in real life. And whenever she's thin, her ratings drop by 12%, you know. And it was inspired by a flip book that I did in the zine where people could cut out the drawings.
Flip the pictures,
yeah, and
you get fat and
staple
skinny.
It together, and you can make Oprah get fat and thin however many times you like. But on the website, you just click on the button and the animated GIF goes to town and she gets fat and thin and fat and thin while you read about how crazy she is. I mean, I love Oprah, but I think that she's great at any size. She's a little bit over the edge.
But she's all right when she's fat, obviously.
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
The site is Fat Zone. There's lots of other cool stuff we haven't had time to talk about.
Uh-huh.
All right, thanks a lot. I want to talk about
another
one. All right, Deborah.
Hi.
How you doing? All right,
good.
Now you've got a site called Fat Girl, right, as opposed to Fatso.
Right.
And what would the difference be between Fat Girl and Fatso?
Well, the difference would be is that we're the zine for fat dykes and the women who want them, so it's pretty gender specific.
Very gender specific.
Yeah.
And you're kind of a little harder, a little edgier, a little sort of more for I mean, there's like men, fat men stories and Fatso. You're not going to find that in Fat Girl, are you?
No, it's just sort of not our focus, really, at all. I mean, you know, we have a lot of fans who are men, but it's just sort of beside the point in terms of, you know, it's really by and for queer women.
Right.
And so, you know, but it is also pretty militant, you know.
Militant in what way? If you go in there, what are you going to see?
Fed up. Oh, well, the website actually is not so much. The website
does
have some good actions and survival tips, basically, because you're dealing with such a fat-hating society.
Yeah,
I mean, you're dealing with, no matter what size you are, if you're a woman, you're expected to diet. And it's
just
for sugar.
Right,
I mean, you know.
Right.
So it's pretty much, you know, the website is not quite like our paper zine, which started first.
So you started actually in a magazine or a newsletter kind of thing.
Oh, yeah, a zine,
then did the website, the zine afterwards.
Right, and the paper zine is very sexually graphic. It's very sexually experimental.
Which you don't really have on the website.
No, in fact.
Why is that? I mean, the website's kind of a little more neutral.
It's a totally different audience, really, as a search of our
blog. Well, you don't know who's going to come in there, I guess, if you're running a
website.
That's
true. You really have to go out of your way to find our paper zine. You have to be looking for it, essentially, or in an alternative bookstore, or, you know.
All right, so let's talk about what is on the website, though. I mean, first of all, you got some neat cartoons there, which are very well done and very funny.
Max Airborne, yeah.
Yeah, so where did you get those, and are they printed somewhere, or they exist only on the website?
No, they exist, they exist in a zine as well, the paper zine. Most of the material on the website does come from our paper zine, but designed, you know, somewhat differently. We don't put anything too graphic up there, not just in terms of photos, but I mean, you know, basically, a search of our weblogs show that most people find us through pornographic searches.
Oh, really? That's where they start.
Yeah. So we kind of see that it's a different audience entirely.
Yeah, but what are you trying to accomplish, though? Not in your magazine, but in the website, in terms of the women who go there and what they're trying to find.
Right.
There.
Mostly we put up resources, contemporary current resources. Whereas, you know, the paper zine doesn't come out as often. It comes out every 4 months.
But the same idea, I mean, as we were talking with Fat, so really to help a woman who's fat. You'll say so what.
It's for support. Yeah, it's to basically, you know, for a little bastion of sanity in a crazy world.
Yeah.
And
good.
But also resources, how to hook up with other women who are actually, you know, size acceptance activists in a different
size
parts of the country.
Size acceptance activists.
Or even shopping, you know, where can I find catalogs of, you know, I'm out in the middle of nowhere, blah, 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 you know.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah,
Bad
thank
girl.
You. Yeah.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you three cool files. That's right, about 4 megabytes of data during the next 120 seconds. You can actually see the data downloading to your PC right over here. Now, to get the data through the TV signal, you need a TV modem, or you can download the files from our website at www.pctv.com using your regular modem, and download time at 28.8 will be almost 30 minutes. Now, let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, there's a new movie out called To Jillian on Her 37th Birthday. The film stars Michelle Pfeiffer. It's the story of a man trying to cope with the grief of losing his wife in a boating accident. The movie takes place on picturesque Nantucket Island off the coast of Massachusetts. We're sending you two clips from the movie so you can check it out before you head off to the theater. Who's the most famous woman in the world? No, I'm not talking about Madonna. Okay, at least whose face is the most well-known? Well, how about the Mona Lisa, the classic painting by Leonardo da Vinci? We're going to send you a JPEG file of this famous masterpiece. It's part of the collection at the Louvre in Paris, but it can now be part of your digital art collection, too. And if you'd like some help organizing your life, we're sending you a cool, family-oriented home organizer program called DTE HomeWise. It helps you keep a family calendar, maintain family medical records, keep data on pets, plants, and everything else you have around the house. If you have a busy household, this is sure to help keep things on the right track. Remember, we're sending all three files to you, about 4 megabytes of data, in under 2 minutes. That's about a megabyte every 30 seconds. If you need information on how to use or find a TV modem so you can do the fast download, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. We'll explain exactly what the TV modem is and how you can get one for yourself. You'll also find information there on how to download the files directly over the Internet. So now it looks like the download is just about complete. Have fun with your three new files. Remember, if you need more information, check out our website at www.pctv.com. And that wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Giles Bateman.
Amy, thanks very much for coming. Now, you are handling the website for lesbian.org. Now, why did you create lesbian.org?
There were a couple of reasons. When I first got on the internet a couple years ago, I looked around and didn't find a lot of information that addressed me personally. There were a lot of websites that focused on women's issues, and there are lesbian issues that are also women's issues. And then there are also websites that focus a lot on gay issues. And again, there are some gay issues, male and female, that apply to lesbians, but I wanted to create a site that would focus just on lesbians and the special needs that they might have or interests that they might have coming online and wanting to find out more about.
So what are some of the unique things about being a lesbian? I mean, obviously there's lots of women's sites and there's lots of gay sites. So what's unique about, you know, the lesbian websites that you think are relevant?
Well, part of the reason I built the site was for women to be able to find each other, first of all, to be able to communicate with other women who are going through the similar issues that they might be going through, to find out other lesbians in their area or what other women struggling with their identity.
So people haven't come out, basically.
Right.
Okay.
People want information about coming out. People want information about support groups in their area. What is it like to be a lesbian mom? What is it like to be a lesbian and go to the doctor and have them be confused by the kinds of things you might say? And I wanted it to be, more than anything, a place for a group of people who doesn't have much visibility in the culture to come together and find each other and know that they're not alone. It's one thing to be in the San Francisco area and know that you can see lesbians whenever you walk out the front door, but if
right.
you live in rural Nebraska, chances are good that you might be the only lesbian in your town. But if you get on the internet, suddenly you don't feel so alone. You can communicate with women who might be in, you know, rural Washington. And they can talk about similar issues and what are some good reading material to read, what are the good movies to watch, you know, lesbian-themed movies, share information about lesbian culture and issues. And that can happen on the internet in a way that it doesn't happen any other way.
So now, give me an example. If I was, for example, if I hadn't come out yet and I was going to the website and there's lots of different places I could get information, but what if I just wanted to talk to somebody? How would I... I wasn't out, so I didn't want to talk to somebody. I kind of wanted to just kind of feel my way around, literally, to understand, you know.
There's a variety of resources available on the site, just information that you can read. But then there also, you have access to web-based message boards, which can be pretty anonymous. You don't have to give out any information in order to participate in them or to read what other women have written. You can also join mailing lists, which is slightly less anonymous. But still, your privacy can be as protected as you want it to be if you don't feel comfortable being out. You can join a mailing list to discuss those very issues, coming out issues. Or you can also join a list to discuss lesbian writing, if you're a lesbian writer, any kind of issue on any kind of topic.
So anything specific to your interest and your background.
And you can find a link to there's a page on lesbian.org that explains what all those different mailing lists are about and how to join them and what are the criteria for joining them. So there's a lot out there.
So now, Is there any particular sites that if you were talking to somebody who wanted more information, is there one site of all sites that you'd recommend they go to?
Well, lesbian.org.
Absolutely. So that's basically the link that will take you to anywhere else that you want to be.
From there, you can find just about any other lesbian-related website there is, including a set of my favorite sites. So you can find that right from the front page.
That's great. Well, Amy, thanks a lot for your time. That was really interesting.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Janelle Brown, and I'm the co-producer of Bitch. Bitch is a website for women, feminists, media addicts, and anyone who just wants to chat. If you're interested in talking about obnoxious alcohol advertising, TV shows with stupid women in them, or sexist movies, this is a place where you should come to get your 2 cents worth, because that's what bitching is for.
So you're from the Exotic Dancers Alliance. Can you kind of define what an exotic dancer is?
An exotic dancer is somebody who dances for a living in an erotic, exotic, naked, stripping way. I mean, this is just
so it's a pretty broad definition. Yeah. I mean, it could be
stripper, peep show worker, prostitute who likes to dance on the street.
Young, old, yeah. Any of those things. Yeah. Great. So what does the Exotic Dancers Alliance actually do?
It's an organization that provides, it's a nonprofit organization, and it provides a voice or a front or a group, a support group for any woman who is a dancer or who was a dancer to voice their concerns or their issues or their problems.
Any estimates like how big a group you're really talking about?
It fluctuates anywhere from, I think, 4 to 20.
Oh, of your group.
Pretty small.
Okay,
yeah,
right. I actually meant also like national. Do you know like how many exotic dancers are really?
I don't. But there's
it's a large
lot.
Group.
There's a lot of them. So it's become very popular.
So the work you're doing is pretty important. Pretty important stuff. So now you have a website.
We have a website.
And what can I find on the EDA website?
You can find a lot of information about your rights as a worker, your rights as a dancer, your rights as a person. You can find a calendar of events. You can find it when to go to meetings. You can find magazines and stories and photographs.
And I imagine it's sort of an issue-oriented place as well. What are some of the issues that you know that exotic dancers are facing right now?
The biggest issue is concerning our status, employee status versus independent contractor status. We're dealing with some lawsuits. We're dealing with
lawsuits between dancers and
our manager or bosses and the clubs.
So, in a sense, are women being exploited, or what's happening?
What's basically happening is there's been a shift. For many years, we were considered independent contractors. We paid a stage fee. We started off paying no stage fee. We started paying a stage fee.
So you had to actually pay to start dancing?
That's right. We paid for the opportunity to work in a lucrative environment, and it was minimal in the beginning, and it grew to be quite large, and that's where the lawsuits began, and that's where the lawsuits started to be won, and a lot of dancers were awarded large sums of
money.
Yeah.
So, and I imagine the issues were things like when you're an employee, you get health benefits, you get minimum wage, you get things like that,
and
you weren't getting those.
Instead of signing a contract every day that says that, you know, if you happen to die in our bathroom, well, that's your problem.
Every day when you show up to work, you have to
sign a contract that states that you're responsible for your being regardless of anything. If you get arrested because you're out, you fall down the stairs, it's your business.
So the work you guys are doing is really, it sounds really important stuff.
It is, mostly because it's placed for a really marginalized group of women to have some solidarity and to feel empowered and go there and feel like
now,
they have a voice.
And that kind of makes me think also the stereotype you would have of an exotic dancer is not someone who would be sitting at home on a computer.
But you'd be surprised because dancers have enough money to buy a computer. So
it is a lucrative. It is a lucrative business. And so you feel like you're reaching a lot of people online?
I hope so. I think our counter is broken.
Yeah, so you don't know how many hits you've actually been getting.
I think we get hit quite a bit because if somebody looks up exotic dancer looking for some sex thrill, they're going to find us. And maybe they're going to be curious about a different sort of sex information.
Oh, so that's really interesting. So people who actually may be online searching for porn may actually get an education in the meantime.
Yes.
So you're kind of furthering the cause that way.
It's for a lot of people. Our main purpose is it's for women. It's information for other women who may feel really estranged in their business and feel exploited to go and find out what their rights are and what they can do about it and how they can reach us and become a little bit larger than just themselves.
And just a small group on it. Now it's on a global level.
Right.
Great. Well, thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Andrew, I think you kind of hit it on the head at the beginning of the program. You talked about using the web to represent traditionally underrepresented people, and that's really what we saw tonight. Not only women on the web, but these subsets, these smaller groups of women who really need this kind of voice.
Right, and we saw a very underrepresented group, strippers, this Exotic Dancers Alliance. There's definitely a stereotype of women that do this as not being real people, and we got to see, first of all, that they are real people, and they have some real-world problems, things like not having good working conditions. conditions, right. not having benefits and things like that. And these women were able to create this site and actually get a union started. And now some of those
using the power of the web right, organizing community.
And the conditions are getting better. So.
You know, it was really interesting in talking about, you know, the different facets. I mean, the fact that we saw women as being multiple-dimensional women, not just these media images and movies and those types of things. As, you know, looking at the lesbian.org website, knowing that there are women with very specific needs. And also, going to WomensNet at the Beijing website, you know, now we have this forum where we have all women across the globe who agree to the key issues and concerns for them, and they're actually taking action on it. That's really exciting.
Yeah, you're both talking about the power of the web for women. What I liked also is we saw restraint on the web. When I talked to Deborah from the Fat Girl website, she said they also publish a magazine, and I look at their print magazine. It's very graphic. It's very pornographic, in fact. And yet they chose not to put that stuff on their website because they understood the web is a different kind of publishing. It's open to everyone. So we saw really netiquette. We saw self-restraint. No government board had to say, don't do that. They understood the right way to use the web, and I kind of like that, too.
Yeah, me too.
Well, that's it for tonight at the Internet Cafe. I hope we'll see you here again next week.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Worked with our global partners for about 2 years before the Beijing World Conference on getting women online. We set up workshops on how to use the internet and what it is useful for, and getting women online and sharing information and also providing a platform to get their information out.